To me, it's the heart and soul of Cleveland. It really is. It lights up the night sky, and you see it all the time, and it reminds people that we're still running. I'll never forget when that went out, and converse to that, I'll never forget when it came back.
Before Steel, I worked for Cuyahoga County. Coming from a laid-back court environment to a steelmaking environment where you do have to be mindful that there's sparks and there's loud noises. So it does give you this awareness that you didn't have before.
As the bar cools down, it'll get a layer of scale on it. So when it hits there, it blows the scale off. So it doesn't get imperfections in it, you know?
We think like, oh, blue collar, you know, they're uneducated. That's far from the truth. There's a lot of educated people there that do some really complex and technical things.
So once that bar gets in and it's done, they collapse the mandrel there that wound it up, and they lift it up with the elevator car, pull it out to here.
I think, wow, these people are geniuses, and they know exactly what's going on in the process. And if there's ever a hiccup or a snafu in the process, they know how to fix it and get it back online.
I like to make this joke with my dad that this woman traded in her 3-inch stilettos for a pair of steel-toed boots. It's a different transition for sure. Like my mother, when she would go to work, always looked nice, always dressed to the nines, just always about her business. In the steel mill, she's still the same way. You can see how that same persona that she had in business world and office land is the same persona she has here. She just dressed differently.
My daughter is Ashley, and Ashley is a tractor driver.
So like when I first got into it, I was very timid and just kind of like, I don't want to hurt anybody, I don't want to hit anything, that kind of thing. But now it's kind of like second nature.
Right. Just such a laid back, really delicate flower. And then I see her at work and I'm like, who is this girl? Wow. She's definitely my greatest achievement.
I went from living with my parents and then a year later owning my own home. It was a huge accomplishment, and it's something that I would, I can't believe I could do, if I'm being honest. Just kind of seeing how a lot of people my age are struggling. I'm okay, like money's good. I'm not stressed about doctor visits. I'm not stressed about rent or anything like that.
I think that's all we want for our children. The fact that she doesn't come home upset and angry and she still loves what she does, I think that's success. There was a time when the plant was closed and that flame wasn't burning. You didn't see that flame. And it was almost like something was missing.
When this plant got shut down, I was president of a local union here, and it really hurt me. There was people that called me that had lost their health care, and it was right around the holidays. It was right before Christmas when all of this happened.
John has worked at LTV Steel for 27 years. Now he may lose his job just 3 years before he could have retired.
I've been trying to prepare myself emotionally, which is very hard to do. And starting over at 46 years old isn't that easy.
To not have that flame burning after all these years, it was terrible. And I just couldn't believe, you know, that this was happening. We had protests downtown here in Cleveland, but we also went to Washington, D.C. because of one of the reasons why the company had gone out of business was because of foreign steel being illegally brought into this country.
Steel built America. Steel saves America.
The illegal dumping was a very large part of it. They were being subsidized by their governments. It wasn't just China. They were actually selling steel here cheaper than it cost us to make. Russia was doing the same thing. Russia couldn't compete, and I don't believe to this day can compete with us. Their steel mills still are not modern enough to compete with us on a level playing field. And that's all we were asking for. National defense is a big part of that. I don't think we want to have China or North Korea supplying us with something that if we get in a tiff with them, they're going to stop. And they have that to be held over our head.
The president has the opportunity this week to change all of that by imposing tariffs of 40%. This is essential if we're ever going to recover and be competitive again in this global market.
Duties were put on, and they generally did stop the illegal imports. I got a phone call saying, you know what, I think we might have a fish on the line. I'm going to be meeting with him for dinner, and there might be a chance of starting the mills back up. My reply to Dave was, if you do that, I'll kiss your ass on public square. And then he sent me back a message saying, just a hug is good.
When I walked back in the mill, it was kind of like, man, I can't believe I'm back. Up in the pulpits, they ran everything by hand, you know, levers and stuff. But they went to computers, and a lot of computer technology is going through the finishing mill and the coilers.
They had more responsibility to do their job. They didn't go to the boss and ask them, should I do this or should I do that? They had to make the decisions themselves.
It was a learning curve. Then it took a little while, but we got pretty good at it.
Some people from the President of the United States office had come through here and said down the road in the future, you know, they might like to do something here. They never really alluded to what it was going to be. But eventually, they told us the reason why. They said, you know, you guys do understand and realize this is the most productive steel plant in the world. And the reason why the President of the United States wanted to come here is to prove here's a plant that rose from the ashes, from nothing, to turn it around and become the most productive steel plant in the world.
Now, we haven't just been recovering from a crisis. What we've been trying to do is rebuild a new foundation for growth and prosperity to protect ourselves from future crises. And because of the grit and resilience and optimism of the American people, we're seeing comeback stories like yours all across America.
I couldn't believe it. I was going to get an opportunity to meet the President of the United States, but I was more excited about the people in this plant were going to get an opportunity to meet the President of the United States and have him say, from a shutdown plant, you guys brought it back. Since Cleveland Cliffs bought us, we've been hiring people almost nonstop for every other week.
I remember as a little girl, whenever we'd go out of town and come back in, I'd always see this flame, and I would ask my dad, what is that, Daddy?
Now somebody else has got an opportunity to send their kids to college and buy a house and get a car and live a better life than they otherwise could have.
I was working at the Indiana Dunes National Lakeshore as a visual information specialist. I needed to make a bit more money, and insurance was very important.
See you later.
He grew in a way that I didn't foresee him growing, just kind of as a man. He transformed.
For them, it's like, okay, well, that's what my dad makes. whether my still is in there or not, doesn't matter. They just know that we're a part of that entire process.
Rachel is 9 and she is very silly, very smart, super, super smart.
What's 1,000 plus 1,000 you say? I don't know.
2,000.
My son, Edwin Alcox, he's a tough kid, 6 years old, and just, I don't know, one of the sweetest kids you ever meet.
You don't need to come over here.
Well, let's play the guessing game.
What's the name? No, I don't know. Guessing game.
Finish your point. What's the point? What is the name of the fish?
Swordfish. Yeah.
There's no swordfish.
We're talking about a different fish.
To them, it's almost like being a superhero, right? Because like you make the steel. They call it the hot place. They know daddy goes out there and daddy is producing steel. It's almost like YouTube, right? They put something out on YouTube and it's there and they feel famous. Well, no, daddy is continuously making something that you can go out and buy. This is something cool. This is what you want. You're positive. Nobody's positive.
I just want this one. I really want.
Where'd you add a third one at?
This one.
No. Okay, we'll stop before you add another one. Right now, there's a big push to bring people in, not only because you need bodies to run a steel mill, but at the same time, because you need that experience to transfer to the younger generation.
I was at a railroad at the time, and I was looking for something a little bit more challenging. I've never used anything like that, and it was crazy to me. I was like, oh my God, like this place out here has so much technology that you would not even think of. The classroom part of it was good to learn from, but like in real life, it was like, holy cow, you know?
She's in the same department I retired from. And I love it. It brings tears to me some days thinking that she's out there doing what she does, you know, makes me such a proud father. You know, you graduate from college, well, you're only gonna make starting wages 50, 60,000. You know, she started out at 80. Enough blue-collar jobs have been lost, and they're starting to come back. Just look at the openings that the steel industry has right now. They can't hire enough people. Back in the early 80s, you know, there was a big exodus of manufacturing out of this country. China was shipping steel over here and dumping it for less than it cost them to make it, just flooding the market.
We definitely could see the impact that the steel mills, the ebbs and flows of the steel mill had on the economy around any of the surrounding communities, Gary Hammond, East Chicago, Portage. If any, the infiltration of any foreign steel comes in and causes confusion in the market, right, it will negatively impact all of us. To me, the cost of the product does not oversee the cost of the life to make the product. Cheaper steel, cheaper anything, really, coming from another country. Well, what's the cost of that, right? How many people lost limbs because of that? How many people lost their lives to get that cheaper cost, right? And as humans, right, we have to think of humanity as a whole, not just a dollar sign.
And the hope is that by doing this, by allowing my kids to play in sports that I may not have had access to give them an understanding of what life is like before it hits them. so that when it comes down to it, when he's 40, I just turned 40, but when he's 40, that he is at in a spot in life that I'm not right now, that he's done that much better. That's the objective, because that's how you keep things going. It's how you keep a community going. Making sure that next generation does better, even if it's just a little bit better, but it was better.
Innovation in steel, it gives Cleaves its edge to compete with in the market. Being that here in the United States or our global competition.
Luis and I met in grad school in Colorado.
It is nice to bounce ideas, talk back and forward.
It does lead to some strange Christmas presents. We made the kids metallurgy kits one year when they were little.
Gave us something to talk about, right?
I grew up in Anaconda, Montana. It was a company town for a copper smelter. Our daughter is 15 and our son is 12, Greta and Oscar. When Luis and I moved to Ohio, we didn't have a support system when we moved here. We had to kind of build that from scratch, and it was challenging. Our daughter's really into theater and the backstage aspect of theater. Our son plays lacrosse.
All right, let's do this. As we didn't know anything about lacrosse, and then Oscar started playing, he was a little kid. How old were you?
Kindergarten. It's like 7.
Yeah. So got involved with helping coaching the town's team and learned about the game.
It took some years for us to, you know, build a support system here, but yeah, we really enjoy it. In my hometown, that was a copper smelter, the smelter closed. Those jobs went away, and the town went into decline. Kids like me had to move away and find jobs elsewhere. I see the value that manufacturing jobs can bring to communities and to people. One of our stainless processing plants is having an issue with a particular grade of stainless steel that's kind of tricky to process. They ended up seeing cracks, and so they sent me some chunks of that slab so I could do some analysis on the surface. In our lab, we can do every process that happens in the mill, only sort of on miniature scale. So we can kind of test through all of those scenarios on a laboratory scale to kind of give ourselves a little bit better idea of how it's going to react when we move to the full mill scale. It is a lot of problem solving and detective work.
We're limited by what we know at any point. The discovery is individual, right? We bring the team together and start sharing what they have discovered and their own problems, and then you start finding common challenges between them.
In the motor, an electric vehicle motor runs at quite high frequency. Our goal here is to increase the strength, but also improve the magnetics.
The electrification of vehicles, I think, is one of those things that's gonna change the way we move around without emitting so much CO2. So it's very important that we make these materials. We're working with automakers to have the right materials they're gonna use in these new vehicles. And it's critical that we make it in America. We don't want to depend in another country to reinvent this new technology. Steel is one of the pillar materials that is needed to make new things. And so we're trying to find ways of using other fuels than instead of emitting CO, we emit water, right, H2O. It's a good challenge, and it's a challenge that we need to take on to protect our environment.
I think I probably came into it thinking that it's a little bit of an older, maybe dated type of industry. But then you kind of get into it and you're like, wow, the tools that are at our disposal are really kind of on another level. I started at the Middletown Works facility in 2018 as a process engineer. I didn't know what to expect really at all. I remember my interview vividly. They put me in a huge coverall, you know, on top of my suit that I had dressed up nice for the interview. And they walked me around the steel mill, and I'm just absolutely pouring sweat. But despite all of that, it was beyond interesting. Just from an engineering standpoint, it's almost a marvel. My wife is Kara. We both went to the University of Dayton. She's a school teacher, 7th and 8th grade.
Yeah, good job. Oh, there you go.
We had our daughter just over 2 years ago now.
Come here.
You know, you see these big steel coils go out the door, but then you actually get to see a finished product.
Ready? Here you go. Hold on tight.
Like, oh yeah, like our steel is the stuff that makes that.
Go, 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 go.
It allows you to kind of take some pride in, all right, I've seen how this gets made, and now I can see how it's being used in real life. Having the Middletown Works just down the road from us, it allows you to put into practice more easily what you're thinking of, you know, at your desk. You're kind of looking forward 5, even 10 years out on some of these development projects.
Hey, Luis.
With Brian, we're trying to improve or make some improvements on one product, and we call it Ultraloom.
We're just waiting on the stuff that we're duplicating at Tulane Stamping.
Yes. Yeah, the 2.2 millimeter trial. So that's what one of his tasks was. It's called coordinate trials of an industrial trials of a new development.
So we'll do the comparison after temper mill.
Yes. Perhaps once, twice a week, I'm somewhere in a mill. When you go there in present, you show your face, we make this together. I think that's something very important here in America, that we defend our manufacturing, not only steel, but manufacturing in general. It has to be gratifying for the people to work on something, have a product and make it, right?
Being able to have an impact on the community that you live in, because you know if there's jobs there and there's good schools there and good health care, then your kids have a better chance of wanting to stay there. And so as you're building the community, it continues on.
You always feel like that's us. We're working. Things are going. That furnace is on.
My niece, she goes, look, the workers over there, they're making money. And she pointed to the big flame when we were going over that bridge. And her friend goes, making money? She goes, yeah, when that flame's going, that means people are working.
It's up to the next generation to keep it going. You got to go out there and give it your best. And they've been doing a pretty damn good job of it.
When you work hand in hand with someone every day, you see their life, you see, hey, they're just like me. We come to work every day, we do the same things, we take care of our families, and I think culturally that'll help break a lot of barriers that are there.
It's terrific to know that now the older timers are passing on to the newer kids, you know, their legacy to say, now it's up to you. You make it better than we made it.